together on the resolution.
Thank you.
Well, good morning, everyone. Thank you for joining us this day. It is so nice not to have the screen in front of me, not to have a mask on, and to be able to hear you guys worshiping the Lord through song while I was greeting those who were coming in. We do have one big announcement. As I announced last week, we're just going to be doing one big announcement. And so for this week, our big announcement is it's the Great Pumpkin Newington. Some of you might be familiar with the cartoon, It's the Great Pumpkin Charlie Brown. This year, it's the Great Pumpkin Newington. We are going to be doing an outreach to the surrounding area. And this is going to be an event that is on October 25th. As you know, because of COVID-19, the reality is that trick-or-treating might be canceled. The kids will miss out on the candy, the parents will miss out on the sugar crash after the candy, which we know they're happy for. The teachers will miss out on the anxiety of all the kids, you know, stuffing candy in their face. And we don't want that to happen. And so we're going to be doing it. It's a Great Pumpkin Newington. We're going to be giving away pumpkins for families in the area. We're going to have cotton candy. We're going to have food. We're going to have trunks, where kids can go socially distance and pick up candy, and it's gonna be a huge event. We're sending out flyers all around, so I would love for you to get excited about it. There's going to be an email this week in the weekly email talking about the different ways that we can participate, and I know that this necessarily might not be everyone's cup of tea, but we do have coffee, and so I would love for you. It took me a long time to think of that one. So I'm glad some people laugh, but I would love you, you know, there's all different ways to be involved. There's ways to be behind the scenes, there's ways to be praying. This is a great chance and a great opportunity for us to be able to show that we care about the kids in our community, that we care about their families, and that we just want to love on them. And so there's going to be more information, but please start praying about it. Mark October 25th, that's a Sunday, down on your calendar, and there's going to be more information coming out. With that in mind, this is also our time of tithes and offerings. For those of you watching online or who want to give later, there are the various different ways that you can give online by visiting our website, newingtonwest.ca. For those of you that are here, we have our offering box in the back where you can give privately between you and the Lord. You can do that before or after service. And I would encourage you this week, there are a number of people who in our church had medical issues going on, a few broken bones and things like that. So please be keeping our church family in your prayers. Even as we go before the Lord right now in prayer for his tithes and offerings, I would just ask that as school is starting up next week and as things are going, that you will please keep those who are our church family in prayer as well.
It's been a prayer for the church. I was at the land earlier on, and Rob, right? His name? Friend's
name.
He's not doing good.
Okay.
At all, so keep him in prayer.
So, there's a number of people in our church. If you're not part of our prayer chain, I'm sure there's a way that you can become part of the prayer chain, and we'll get that information out to you. But please keep our brothers and sisters that call Newington their home in your prayer. This week has been kind of a tough week. So let's go before the Lord in prayer. Heavenly Father, we thank you for today. We thank you that we were able to sing worship and praise songs to your name gathered together, Lord. It seems like such a long time that we've been able to do that. And so we give you glory and praise. Lord, we thank you for this beautiful, cool weather after having to meet in such oppressive heat. Lord, we thank you for the cooler weather. We thank you for fall and all the beauty that it brings. Lord, we think of the members of our church that aren't able to be with us here today, and the members of our church who through the week have just gone through various struggles with health and with various illnesses, Lord. And we just pray a special anointing on them. God, I know that you have a plan for Newington, and we all believe that we are here to be a light to our community and to the surrounding community within 20 kilometers. And so, Lord, I just pray protection. I pray that as we share your light, as we share the gospel, that you will protect us from the attack of the enemy. Lord, that you will allow us to be able to press forward with the truth of the gospel. We think of the students that are going back to college and those going back to school and all that that involves. Lord, we pray for protection over the families, protection over the students and teachers, Lord. Most of all, we pray for a sense of calming as anxiety is slowly growing over this and the potential second wave of COVID, Lord. So I just pray for a calming sense that you will be with them, Lord. We ask that you will bless the gifts and the givers for the tithes and offerings, Lord, that it will be able to be used for the glory of your kingdom and for your name. We ask this and pray this in the powerful name of Jesus Christ. Amen.
This morning is found in John chapter 15, verses 1 to 7. Anyway, if you'd like to follow along, and again, that's in the NIV. I am the true vine, and my Father is the gardener. He cuts off every branch in me that bears no fruit, while every branch that does bear fruit, he trims clean, so that it will be even more fruitful. You are already clean because of the word I have spoken to you. Remain in me, and I will remain in you. No branch can bear fruit by itself. It must remain in the vine. Neither can you bear fruit unless you remain in me. I am the vine. You are the branches. If a man remains in me, and I in him, he will bear much fruit. Apart from me, you can do nothing. If anyone does not remain in me, he is like a branch that is thrown away and withers. Such branches are picked up, thrown into the fire, and burned. If you remain in me, and my words remain in you, ask whatever you wish, and it will be given you. Let's start with this one.
I can't really preach the word without having the Bible up on stage, so. There's an old story of a young man who fell in love with a farmer's daughter. And he decided that he was going to go and he was going to ask the father for his blessing on the marriage and for permission to be able to take his daughter as his wife. And the farmer thought it over for a minute, and he said, okay, I'll give my blessing and I'll give my daughter's hand in marriage with no dowry whatsoever if you can touch the tail of a bull. And the, he says, this is a pretty good offer, is what the boy thought, because, I mean, to not have to pay a dowry or anything, to just be able to marry was kind of important to him because she was just so beautiful. And so he said, all right, I'll do this. And the farmer said, well, you know what, I'll give you 3 tries. You know, it's not just 1 try, I'll give you 3 tries to do this. And the boy said, great, great. So the farmer walks away and the boy stands outside in the field in front of the barn. And the farmer leads out the first bull, and it's huge. I mean massive. The boy had never seen a bull this big in his whole entire life. He thought for sure this was some kind of freak of nature. And so as the farmer leads the bull out, the boy thinks there's no way. There's no possible way that this is the bull. I'll wait for the second one. And as the farmer hit the bull and he went charging forward, the boy just ran over to the fence and let the bull run past. He then walked back out and the farmer led the second bull. And this bull was the fiercest the boy had ever seen. And the farmer had to pull it in, and even as he was doing it, he was flipping his horns back and forth, trying to gore anything that he could. The boy thought, there's no way that this I could possibly catch the tail of this bull. It's just too fierce. I'm going to die if I try. And so the farmer lets the bull loose, and without any goading whatsoever, he runs forward, and the boy just goes off to the fence and lets it pass. Then he goes back out into the center of the field, and the farmer brings the third bull. And it's this old bull, barely looks like it could walk. And the farmer is slowly leading him forward, and it seems like perhaps the bull can't even see. It's just so docile, and the boy thinks, oh, this is it. This was the opportunity I was waiting for. I planned it all out. I didn't do the one that was too big or the one that was too fierce. This was it. The Lord is smiling upon me. I got this. And the farmer lets go of the bull, and the bull slowly starts running forward. And as it starts to pass by, the boy reaches and grabs air, because the bull didn't have a tail. Today, I want to talk to you about opportunity. Opportunity. The scripture, we've been studying the 7 churches of Revelation, and our scripture for today is Revelation 3, 7 through 13. Revelation 3, 7 through 13, if you want to turn with me there. I'm going to be reading out of the NIV translation. To the angel of the church of Philadelphia write, these are the words of him who is holy and true, who holds the key of David. What he opens, no one can shut, and what he shuts, no one can open. I know your deeds. See, I have placed before you an open door that no one can shut. I know that you have little strength, yet you have kept my word and have not denied my name. I will make those who are of the synagogue of Satan, who claim to be Jews, though they are not, but are liars, I will make them come and fall down at your feet and acknowledge that I loved you. Since you have kept my command to endure patiently, I will also keep you from the hour of trial that is going to come on the whole world to test the inhabitants of the earth. I am coming soon. Hold on to what you have so that no one can take your crown. The one who is victorious, I will make a pillar in the temple of God. Never again will they leave it. I will write on them a name of my God, the name of my God, and the name of the city of my God, the New Jerusalem, which is coming down out of heaven from my God. And I will also write on them my new name. Whoever has ears, let them hear what the Spirit says to the churches. The Church of Philadelphia is kind of in an interesting place. The first thing is it's one of 2 churches that actually has no correction or rebuke in the book of Revelation. Only 1 of 2. And in fact, of the 2, they seem to be doing pretty well. But the Church of Philadelphia, the believers there, have something kind of interesting that Christ refers to. And what I've kind of found interesting in the study of all this is everything that Christ encourages the church also reflects in the city that they live in. See, the city of Philadelphia was located between the city of Sardis and the city of Laodicea. So the churches that are being written a letter. And as we learned about last week in the city of Sardis, they were very famous for metalworking and everything like this. They had a good, strong government. And as we find out next week, when we continue our study, Laodicea was known for their hot springs and for their cold springs and the rejuvenating of their different waters. And here was Philadelphia in the middle. And Philadelphia had some good volcanic ground. It had some good hot springs. It had some good metalsmiths. It had some good government officials. And it had some good temples, not Christian temples, but other temples that people would worship at. But the thing was, is that they were just good. Compared to the medical practices and the things you could get at Laodicea, they weren't great. And so people would pass by them to go to Laodicea. And compared to the government and the metalworking and the textiles and everything of Sardis, well, they just wouldn't go down to Philadelphia because why bother? Just travel to Sardis. You save yourself a few hours. And so they were good. They were good. They had good stuff, but they were weak in power. They didn't have the extra funding. They didn't have the extra military base. And this reflects in the church, because the church itself, Christ says, you have very little power. You have very little influence in this city. And it's great because, much like all the other churches who have been persecuted during this time because of the Romans, you haven't denied me. You stayed strong. You stayed true. But God makes a promise to them. He makes a promise to them that I am going to empower you. I am going to empower you. And this is what I mean. The definition of empowered is for someone to feel stronger or more confident in something. So if I was to empower you, I would in some way make you feel more, either stronger or more confident. That would be if I was empowering you. It's this idea in sports of a playmaker. I don't know how many people here watch sports. I watch sports both like football, American football. I don't watch soccer. But basically, in any sport, there's what's known as a playmaker. They're the person you want to get the ball to, right? If you get the ball to this person, you know that they're going to try and make a goal. They're going to try and score a point. They're going to try and make it so your team's winning. They're the person that you want to empower, because they are the ones that get it done. I remember when I played basketball in high school, I was not the playmaker. Not even remotely close. But I knew if I managed to steal the ball or get the rebound, who it was I was going to toss the ball to. I remember I would always be yelled at by my coach because I would do a full court press, which is basically as soon as the other team gets the ball, you're on them. And he would be like, Dave, don't get a full court press. Don't do it, don't do it. But I would always do it because I knew that our playmaker had my back. And that if I managed to steal the ball, he was going to right away make it down so that way he could make the goal. I wouldn't make the goal. I wouldn't make the net. But he would. And that is what Christ is saying to Philadelphia. He says, I am the playmaker, but I am going to empower you. And this is what I want us to walk away with. Because this is how God was empowering the church of Philadelphia and how he empowers us. A God-made opportunity is empowering. A God-made opportunity is empowering. See, he promises the church of Philadelphia. He says, look, what I open, no one can close. And what I close, no one can open. And there is a door that I am opening for you, for the believers in Philadelphia, that no one will be able to shut. No one will be able to shut this. I am giving you this opportunity. And I love you so much, Church of Philadelphia. I love you so much that those who have been ridiculing you, those who have been giving you a hard time, I'm going to show them that you have been empowered, because they are going to come and they are going to kneel down before you. And they are going to show respect to you so that way they can see that I love you. See, what's happening is that Philadelphia is being empowered by the playmaker Jesus. He's saying, I am empowering you to be able to grow. I am empowering you to be able to share the gospel, to be able to press on. I am empowering you. I am giving you this opportunity that no one can take away. I love Neil T. Anderson in his book, The Bondage Breaker, says this. In Christ we are important. In Christ we are qualified. We are good. Satan can do absolutely nothing to alter our position in Christ and our worth to God, but he can render us virtually inoperative if he can deceive us into listening and to believing his incestuous lie, accusing us of being little value to God and other people. That's what the Church of Philadelphia was feeling. They had little power. Their city had little power. But Christ says, look, I'm opening this door of opportunity, and no one can shut it. You are empowered because of who you are in me. It's kind of like, I'm sure you have all experienced this. You're driving your car down the road, and you're at an intersection, or maybe there's just another road or a stoplight or anything, and you're like, what the heck, I got time. And you notice that there's a person standing here waiting to go out into the oncoming traffic, right? And so what do you decide? You're like, yeah, I got time. So you just sit there, right? And you're like, and they're so panicky, they're like, and you're like, come on, let's go. And they're like, and finally, like, you're like flinging your arm like, hello, you even want to get out of here? Like, let's go, lady. And I'm not, it could be a guy too. It could be a guy too. But you're like, come on, let's go. And then finally they're like, oh, thanks. You know, and they pull out. And that is what I'm talking about. God is there saying, come on, Philadelphia, I've opened the door. But so often, we're afraid to pull out because we think we have little power, or we think, man, I've been really persecuted, or, you know, it's been a real struggle for me to grow in this area of my life, or I've had these temptations, or, you know, I just feel like I haven't won any victory. And Christ is there saying, you have the opportunity. Your opportunity is there. I am empowering you. I'm waving you forward. Look, I got people honking the horn behind me because they want me to move on. God-made opportunities are empowering. But we have to make sure that we take those opportunities. We have to make sure that when he's waving us forward, we take the opportunity. There's a movie called Remember the Titans with Denzel Washington that I watched a lot in elementary school when it came out. I watched it like every single day it came out. Like, great, phenomenal movie about the merging of white churches and black churches in the South after segregation had slowly started to close. And he was a football coach. And he showed up, and the reason that they hired him, a black football coach, was for an opportunity. An opportunity to take the white football team and the black football team and merge them together. The opportunity he had was he going to show favoritism? And people would show up, and they showed up the first day of camp, and they said, look, I'm the all-star. If you don't have me, you're not going to win any games. And then people from the black school showed up, and they're like, well, I'm better than those guys, and I can beat them any day. And the opportunity he took was to say that the best player plays regardless of skin, regardless of race. He took the opportunity that he saw to build an amazing football team in the midst of segregation and in the midst of melding these two cultures. I think of Newington. We had an opportunity when COVID came to either put services online or just watch whatever it is that we could find. The same with the playmaker. When you give the playmaker the ball, When you enable the playmaker, they make a play. They're the ones that press forward and make sure that you win the game. God-made opportunities are empowering. We are empowered to do everything that we need to for the opportunities that he gives us. But the question is, how do we know what is a God-made opportunity? How do we know that this just isn't me wanting to do something? How do I know that this is actually what God desires me to do? And the answer that we see is that the people of the Church of Philadelphia honored the Lord. They were of little strength, but they continued to press forward. They have kept his commands, and they endured patiently That's what it says in verse 10. Since you have kept my commands and endured patiently, we come to know the opportunities of God that we have by enduring and by plugging in. And when I say plugging in, I mean by keeping his commands to grow in holiness, to be people of prayer, to be people who are reading God's word on a daily basis, to be people that are sharing our testimony, to people who are sharing what it is that God's doing in our life, to be people of evangelism, who are actually going out and telling people, not just testifying what God's doing in your life, but testifying what Christ can do in others' lives. And being a person of discipleship, allowing someone to speak into your life and say, hey, how can I help you grow? Hey, I noticed there's this area that you kind of need to work on. I noticed there's this thing that doesn't really reflect too well on you. That's how we come to know the opportunities. By plugging in, by being people of prayer, reading God's word, testimony, evangelism, discipleship. Those are the commands that were given to us to make disciples, to know God's word and be able to teach. We need to be willing to approach the bowl. We need to be willing to approach the bowl that is in our life, because the bowl that we're facing, the opportunities we have, isn't something big that's overwhelming. It's not something fierce and scary. And it's not even something old that has no tail. It's a bowl that's being led on a rope by the good shepherd and has been trained. And he leads us past us and he says, just touch the tail. Just touch it. You don't have to pull. You don't have to yank. You're not a toddler. It's just a little touch. The opportunity is there. But we have to be willing to approach the bowl. So my question for you this week is, what's an opportunity that you need to take? What is an opportunity you need to take? I don't think any one of us is perfect in any of the areas that I listed. Heaven knows that I could probably pray a little bit more than I do. I could probably read God's word and study it a little bit more. I can share testimony of what God's doing in my life a little bit more. I can step out in evangelism, not one of my strong suits. You want to talk about something that makes me feel awkward? It's evangelism. It is not one of my strong suits. And I'm sure I can certainly be discipling people better. I'm sure that I can be speaking into their life and I can be honing how it is that I can help others grow, and I can be finding someone who can continue to help me to grow. God-made opportunities are empowering. We find those opportunities by plugging in. My question this week, my challenge, is what opportunity do you need to take? What opportunity? Are you going to let the bull pass by? Or are we going to take the chance to be empowered by the Lord to do what he said no man will shut, no man will stop? Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for today. We thank you for being able to gather together. Father God, we thank you for your Holy Spirit, which empowers us. And I know I come before you knowing that there are areas where I can improve on this list. That there are areas where I don't always take the opportunities. But I am so thankful that your opportunities are never closed. Lord, I pray that you will empower us as we go through this week to be able to act and to know the opportunities that you have for us to glorify your name, the opportunities to spread the kingdom in our areas of influence, that people will know your name, Jesus, that they will know why it is that you came to live this life. I ask that you will continue to bless the efforts of the ministries here, and that we will forever be focusing on how we can take opportunities to share the gospel. Pray this in the powerful name of Jesus Christ. Amen. I pray that each one of you will be empowered this week by the power of the Holy Spirit, and that you will act on the opportunities that he gives. God bless.